You're on the
stretch
right.
To your left. Hello, friend. Do you know what left is? Left. All right. Bring your hands round in a circle, as if you just woke up in the morning and this is your first talk this entire 3 days. Oh yeah. All right. Just remember, every single session we got brand new panel of speakers, so they have not been repeating this at all. Every single panel is a different bunch, a different group. So you're getting fresh content for every single one. All right, now shake your hips. Oh. And then you've got comfy beat mic. You're gonna be just relaxed after that, all right? Now twitch a bit.
Shimmy
a bit. All right, now have a seat and let's get started. I know this room gets a bit chilly, so do let me know if you get a bit cold over there, okay? I'll just get another beanbag and put it on top of you as a blanket. Right, let's get rolling. This session is called Funding Your Ideas, Crowdfunding and Crowdsourcing. I think the title is pretty self-explanatory. So for today's panel, we've got two fabulous guests and one pretty cool guy as our moderator. I have for you Sam Sharpie. He's on our panel today. He is the co-founder of Pitchin. And what Pitchin is, it's a crowdfunding platform in Malaysia that was co-founded in 2012 over here. It has the largest amount of crowdfundings in Southeast Asia, and it's a platform that has, it also records the number of people supporting a single project. Essentially, he's the guy you would want to talk to if you want to raise funds, because he can tell you exactly what is the best avenue to do, I mean, to get this fund. Our next panel speaker is, of course, Scott. He's a growth advisor, investor, and mentor to ventures around the globe. He helps founders transform their ideas to products, products to sales, and ventures to businesses. Moderating our panel today, we have Lias de Oliveira. She's from Startup Grind. And Lias, this is your first time moderating with us, even though yesterday you were heading the Startup Youth and Conference. Tell us a bit more about what you do with Startup Grind.
Okay.
Hello.
So basically, who has already attended Startup Grind in here? Anywhere in the world? So it's a pretty new crowd. Oh, okay, so Startup Grind is a global startup community. We're in over 170 countries. What we do is put a monthly excuse to bring entrepreneurs together in each of these cities with the goal of building communities. So we believe that entrepreneurs need support peer-to-peer and they need to be connected in an ecosystem. So we build a lighthouse, which is monthly held. So anyone who's interested in entrepreneurship can see Startup Grind as your meeting point that happens every month. At the same time, with a very, very good excuse, high quality content, which is generally an interview with the best entrepreneurs in the city. So we've had people like Ben Superman from Pinterest, Brett Hawker from LinkedIn, and in KL, for instance, Kyria, Patrick Grove, Cheryl Yeo, and other great entrepreneurs. Our next event is on this Thursday, by the way, commercial time. So it's on this Thursday at 7 p.m. in Bangsar. So that's for more details. And I'm also community ambassador for Magic.
All right, thank you very much, Lias. And do attend that event on Thursday as well if you're in Malaysia. So what we're having is this little session. It's called Funding Your Ideas, Crowdfunding and Crowdsourcing. Lias, take it away.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Isabel. So to start with, it's very, very cool conversation to have. It's kind of in fashion to talk about crowdfunding. There are full conferences happening right now, and suddenly people see what internet provided to us from connectivity to having masses of people online is that why do we need to go far away through investment banking or investors, VCs to get funded if I can get the crowd to do so? Still yet is not the most common thing, although everyone is talking about it. So we want to learn in this session on what are the advantages of crowdfunding, what are the success cases in that, how to replicate those success cases. But to just warm up a little bit, I'd like you, both of you, to introduce yourselves, what you've done, and in that, why would you join a panel about that topic? And what's your experience with crowdfunding? You don't have this, show the people that I know you have experience, okay? Okay. So let's start yourself.
Right. Okay. Evening, everyone. My name is Sam. So I'm actually the co-founder of Pitchin. Malaysia is possibly one of the first crowdfunding platform in Malaysia, which we launched in June 2012. It was 3 years ago, right? So 3 years been an experience running a platform, a crowdfunding platform in Malaysia. It is very, very different from a platform if you're running it from the US or Europe. And they probably will deal with that in terms of the challenges running a platform such as Pichin in Malaysia and also in Asia. The attitude of project owners and sole funders are different from what you see, say, in Kickstarter or Indiegogo. And I hope to actually touch a bit more on that later on. We have a reward crowdfunding platform. Tomorrow, the Securities Commission will be announcing the license operators for the Equity crowdfunding platform. We're crossing our fingers that we'll be one of them because we did apply for them. So we're going up against, from what we hear, 15 to 20 other companies that's applying. And those companies are coming not only from Malaysia, but also from other countries from this particular region and also from Europe. Yeah? So that'll be interesting. So that's my introduction.
Awesome. Good afternoon. I've got a couple of different questions first. How many of you have ever bought anything through a crowd site online? A watch, a t-shirt, a video, a social campaign? Okay, half a dozen. How many of you have looked at sites online, at least looked at them, that are crowd sites? Yeah, not foreign ones, the other ones. Okay. I'm based in Dubai. I am a partner in Capital Crowdfund Associates. They're a group that is based in the US, but I'm the person in the Middle East who helps them, and they were the ones that got the US Jobs Act passed, and they were one of the pioneers, I guess I'll call it, in moving the crowdfund needle from idea to action. And the US has been a lagger in getting the equity laws in place, but I don't think it's the laws. I think it's more the Treasury Commission in terms of that. As an individual, I've been involved in the spectrum of investments. I'm an individual angel investor. I've contributed in crowd campaigns. I have been helping teach crowd stuff. We just did a World Bank project in Kenya in trying to teach Kenyans how to take this to market. So they're a bit more emerging than you guys are, further behind. They're a different stage of development in terms of activities, and they have very different kinds of projects that they're going on. And what we would like to share today, or at least I would, is the opportunity for you to be involved in it. But like sports, this is a participation game. You can't do it through books. You have to play on the field.
Interesting. Let's start by talking a little bit about examples of companies who have succeeded so far with crowdfunding. I've done a quick research because on top of my mind, I could just think of hardware companies. And as I did my research, what I found on the top 10 were hardware companies, mainly IoT. And I was like, well, I would like to learn more about it, but first of all, what are the success cases you know globally and in Malaysia, in your experience, and why do you think this IoT thing is predominant in the global perspective?
Yeah. Great question, Liz. If you talk about big projects in the world, you can't talk about it without mentioning Pebble. Yeah? Mm. Pebble has actually did two world records. First time with 15 million before that, what you call the project, which is quite disappointing because it was really, what do you call it? It's called the second project that actually beat Pebble the first time. Yeah, I know, but it's something where you bring to your to the beach for when you go to picnics. So,
cooler,
yeah, the coolest. Yeah. They actually beat the Pebble and became the world record holder with 60 million before the Pebble time came back 2 months ago and raised 20 million. So Pebble has actually raised $35 million from the crowd from nearly what? 250,000 people around the world, just staggering. Yeah, and I actually pledged 3 watches, twice at the first round and one for the latest one, which I'm still waiting for my watch. Now, I think why Pebble was so successful is because, first of all, the story behind Pebble is this. When they wanted to start this, nobody wanted to actually invest in them. No VCs, no angels, neither any banks wanted to invest in them or give them money to actually start Pebble Watch. And what happened, they turned to the crowd. And the crowd validated the whole idea about smart watches. I've always believed that the reason why we see Apple Watch, Samsung, all of them going into drones, into smart watches, is because people like Pebble actually validated the whole idea. And what they did on Kickstarter was validation that allowed or pushed people like Samsung and Apple to then start doing their own smart watches. So you talk about world record holders, you can't avoid talking about Pebble. But again, there are also other projects, field projects, such as, Kristen Bell was the lead actor in that particular film. I think that's probably right now the highest amount ever crowdfunded for a field project. Closer to home, we actually crowdfunded an indie festival in Penang, Tapau Fest, which raised nearly 90,000 ringgit within 30 days. Mm. Not as great as what we see in Kickstarter, Indiegogo, but for Malaysian, for ASEAN, it's pretty, pretty awesome. Mm-hmm. We also did one project which allowed moviegoers to actually pick a particular film, which is not shown anymore on the theatre, but people crowdfunded, and this particular person, Alan Chong, managed to raise 10,000 ringgit after paying off the hall rental plus the movie. I think he made 6,000 ringgit for that particular project. For him, it's a business.
Yeah.
He does this two or three times per month. You're looking at 18,000 ringgit per month's income, which is not too bad for a 22-year-old guy.
Yeah.
So,
Can I ask something? I want to listen more. But looks like whenever something I can consume immediately, other consumer products or entertainment, this generally for now determines all the case of success. You've given an example, right?
Yes, projects will succeed if it's interesting, right? But I think the most important part, and this is based from my own experience, the 3 years we've run pitching, is that it really, really boils down to the project owner themselves. How transparent are they? How excited are they? And how much they're willing to work hard to actually get people to be informed about their project.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the number one mistake that most project owners in Malaysia do is that they don't do any groundwork before they even list their projects on PitchIn, right? Mm-hmm. I think this false impression that if I put my project on the crowdfunding site, be it PitchIn or even Kickstarter, people will just come in droves and throw me money. It doesn't happen that way. You need to actually start talking about your project at least a month, even before you start putting it on the crowdfunding platform. I think that's very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think a lot of projects in PitchIn or even in Asian based platforms are not doing that well, and that's what I see where the weakness is in terms of starting something here in Asia.
Interesting. So it's basically about you're trying to sell something without building a community, without building a relationship previously with your potential users,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
When I believe that ownership or transferring a bit of ownership to the user, to your consumer, seems like a fundamental thing for crowdfunding. How do you perceive it? I have the same question. I want to listen from your experience and success cases. And adding that, like, what is the pattern you identify in these success cases?
A couple of background points first is I think we're mixing crowd stuff across the spectrum. So if I take the right-hand side, there's crowd products that you can buy online. That's not crowdfunding. That's normally pre-sales of products, like the Pebble Watch was a product that you could touch. It was conceived and the individuals were trying to buy tooling for the company. They weren't really crowdfunding. What they were trying to do is pre-sell product. So they had an objective of a couple hundred thousand dollars that they were originally trying to sell. They smashed that target. So for any startup in this room, I would encourage you to think about, is your product something you can put in a crowd campaign and pre-sell? Now most of those are only for 60 to 90 days, And I would encourage you also to practice. Go invest $10, $20 and go buy something. See how the whole process works. I've bought dozens of things from watches to clothes, and I often give them away as gifts. It's a wonderful way to do it, to share with people their gadget people or innovation type things. The second is there's social things. You can invest in indie events or causes or things like that. So they're not a product in the traditional sense of I'm buying tooling for my company. I might run Startup Grind. I might need 3 sponsors for the event in Penang. I might need some help for that, and I might run it through a crowd event. So am I getting feedback that we can kill on one of these?
I think you just have to speak a tiny bit into the mic and we can turn the volume down.
Okay, I will try.
We love hearing your voice, Scott.
The third one is crowdfunding. This is where the equity issue comes in, or debt, and there's 2 forms fundamentally. Is just like if you're a company and you're offering shares in a pitching competition, you can offer debt or equity online. Now, in almost every country, there are regulations in terms of offering shares or debt online because you have to have transparency of the financials, and there's the issue that you may be falsifying information. So each country has a regulatory process, and that's why it's lagged many times from the law as to when those exchanges or setups will occur. In the Middle East, there is an organization called Eureka, which has done about 20 online crowdfunding businesses. Some of them have raised their funding of $250,000 in the space of 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Now, those are sometimes hardware products. Often they're very zany things, so they're not necessarily physical, complex businesses. They're just businesses that need some money, and they're willing to share. In fact, one of them was a fitness company called CoreFit, and it's like yoga and other fitness activities. And what they did was they offered shares in their business. So it doesn't have to be the traditional, I've got a app, or I've got a piece of hardware, or other gadget. So there are some different techniques. Now, each country or region varies with this, and before you go into crowdfunding, you should always think about where you're domiciled. So the first question you have to ask is, if I'm a Malaysian company, then I have to comply with Malaysian laws because that's where your company's based. If you're in the Middle East, which there are advantages to being in the UAE, we have a different kind of tax system in case you don't know. Zero. So there's a motivation for some people that want to set up there that there's zero income tax for personal or companies. So that's part of the reason why they're getting some attention for their crowdfunding site, is that investors like that because when they get returns, they don't have a tax on them. So I'm giving you a couple of examples. So just think at the beginning of the spectrum. First is product, which is what I would call Pebble. The second is social in the middle, and the third is funding. And they're different categories, so the spectrum's crowd stuff.
Yeah.
But crowdfunding is just one of those categories.
That's very interesting. And we need to talk about funding. About all of three, but funding, I think, is something I want to focus on here. Because what I found most common, what we expect to have in this room, potentially, are startups, app-based or software-based. And these startups may offer a benefit to the crowd, which is their product, even though they are not a physical product. For example, a marketplace for fitness. I still have users who use it, but the benefit I would offer to people who are funding us is not I'm going to send them my product or I'm going to give them a subscription. It's equity most of the times.
Maybe.
So what I want to learn about the experience you guys have exactly in there. So just make sure that we cover everything and giving you guys also a perspective of how I want to lead the conversation and if you want to add anything new. Also, want to talk from the perspective of the funders, because we all can put our startups to be funded, but we can as well be funders. And I also want to understand from the founder perspective, what would they, how do they get into it, right? How do they get started, or how, what to pay attention to if they strategic investment, and what does crowdfunding mean? If I'm deciding instead of having Sequoia as my investor, I decide having a crowd. So we're going to try to cover all the things if we have time and give it back to the crowd for 20 minutes so that they can ask you questions.
Crowd.
So going back, let's focus on funding because there's lots of things to talk about. What are the models you find in terms of crowdfunding of participation? Why would I invest in a startup? Why would I fund a startup?
That's a tricky question because it's not just a crowd thing. It's an appetite issue. So investing is a spectrum. I can invest in the stock exchange, I can invest in property, I can invest as an angel, or I can invest in as a crowd. Crowd just creates ease, is the thing I would say is number one, is on a website, there's a video, there's an offer on the background, and there's some financial information. So I can quickly look at the information. The difference between buying a product is it normally is tangible and it's small. If I'm crowdfunding a business, they normally have to go through a vetting process to be prepared. And that means that there is an organization that has done the work beforehand. So in the case of Eureka, they will do a prep work, they will go through a checklist, and they will warrant that they've done these things. Mm. They don't warrant the company, they warrant that they've got a founder, that they're legally set up in the UAE.
Like a due diligence.
I'm going to say a different word. Due diligence is a risk management issue.
Okay.
This is a checklist.
Okay.
There's a subtle distinction there. Mm. They're not warranting that it's correct. They're warranting it exists. So in the case of the UAE, they may have a company set up there. They will say that the structure exists. It's your job if you want to go check that. For you to go check that. That's your due diligence.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the difference. Due diligence is still your responsibility as the investor.
Mm-hmm.
But they create this packet of information, or a data room. The second thing is, it comes down to your pitch.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you're an angel investor looking at this or a crowd site, it is very important on how you package what you're offering. So if you have a good spiel, you have, this is the problem, this is our solution. This is our market potential. This is how we do it. We have had traction. We've done X amount of sales so far, and it works. That's all good. If you can't do that, I just have a dream, you will probably not be funded. So almost all of the businesses that we've seen that have gotten funding have to show problem, solution, solution, market, some data points of sales, some information on the individuals in the team so that they have some credibility, and what I would call a genuine open book. You need to be transparent.
Mm-hmm.
And in various countries, that's very hard to find. So when we go to Kenya, being open book is hard.
Mm.
In the US, it's easy because they have to be. It varies by market. Does that help?
A lot. And I want to bring it back to Sam because I think you have exactly a lot of experience on what he was saying, right? So go ahead.
Okay, I suppose when you talk about crowdfunding, especially when startups approach pitching as a means for them to raise money, I always look at it at, as whether they're actually more suitable for reward crowdfunding, or they will have to wait for equity crowdfunding when it becomes legal in Malaysia. Now, if you already have a product and it's an idea stage, you want to launch it, then maybe a reward crowdfunding platform would be the better, option to do it. Because under the framework issued by the Securities Commission, there is no way that you guys can list your company on a platform if it's just an idea stage. There's no way. There has to be some financial background to your company. So normally we'll be looking at the company which has probably 2-3 years of financial activities before they could actually list their companies on the crowdfunding platform. So if you're early stage and you're looking at trying to validate your idea and whatnot, then reward crowdfunding would be the best option. I have an example. Three guys that came to pitch in and they wanted to start a t-shirt company, right? They put in some designs on pitch in. They wanted to raise $3,000 and they managed. They wanted to raise $1,000 and they managed to raise nearly $3,000. Yeah, no, $7,000. Now, from the money, and after printing all the T-shirts which people actually paid in advance to get, they were left with around 10,000 ringgit
which allowed them to actually start the company, right? So that's a great example of someone or a group of people who wanted to test out their ideas, their designs, before actually committing themselves to a business, right? So they got the support from the crowd loved the design. After printing all the t-shirts, they got some money left and they then started to set up their own company. Now, but if you're a company which already has raised money from, say, Cradle 150 or Cradle 500, and I think startups who have gone through this particular journey will always find it difficult to raise their next round of funding, your Series A funding, right? So that's where I think platforms like equity crowdfunding platform will come in to address. And that's where we hope that not only we can funnel all these great companies to angels and also sophisticated investors, but also people like the guy on the street. Now imagine Grab Taxi or My Taxi, it was then. If an equity crowdfunding platform was there, after they raised 150, I don't know whether they raised 500 from Cradle, I'm not sure. But they raised, right, 500? So after 500, they were going around town trying to raise more money. They went to Khazana. Khazana took the longest time to decide. In the end, they went to Singapore. But had, for argument's sake, had an equity crowdfunding platform be available, and Anthony would probably go there, you guys, if you had taken the bet to actually bet on him and the company, you guys are now looking as probably part owners of a $1 billion valuation company, right? Mm. For My Taxi. So we're hoping that some of those startups which are finding it difficult to actually raise more money will then come to the equity crowdfunding platform. And I think Scott nailed it very correctly. You need to be very, very transparent. In fact, we expect when companies come to the equity crowdfunding platform, they need to have a mentality of actually trying to raise money in the public offering, in IPO. So yeah. You need to have that mentality. You need to be very, very aware that you need to be very, very transparent. You need to show all your financial records. Yeah, because in the end, people will be looking at that as a means for them to actually decide whether they want to invest in you or not. Mm. Yeah, and I think that will be probably the number one challenge for startups in Malaysia.
Transparency. Keeping books in order. Precisely. To start with.
Yeah, because we run an accelerator ourselves. I can tell you the horror stories of startups with their bookkeeping.
Yeah,
it's not pretty. So
does it exist? It's good that at least it's not pretty. Sometimes it doesn't exist.
Yeah, yeah.
That's amazing. We're talking a lot about how to get crowdfunding, and I appreciate that a lot about the pitching, a lot about the sale. If you think it's harder than pitching an investor for seed or Series A, because at least when you're pitching an investor, you get in a room with five of them and you pitch them and they ask you questions. But when it's a crowd, you gotta keep the attention of people who are already so busy online. So how do you get them to pay attention to you? That's exciting to talk about, but I'd like to take a step back and talk about, the fuck is that? And talk about why would someone want crowdfunding rather than go towards traditional investment? And I'm gonna challenge just with a concept, which is not because I believe in that, but I wanna challenge it. I wanna be invested by 500 startups because then I'm gonna be mentored by them. Why would I go for crowdfunding?
Good question, but I think we're mixing issues. Most ventures have one resource in scarcity more than money, and it's time. And the best analogy I can do is scuba diving. You have a tank of air on your back. When you're underwater and you run out of air, you're done. So every week we all start with 168 hours. It's how we use it. And yes, you might want to have access to mentors from the best in the world, be it YC or 500 or, you know, wherever.
You name it.
I suggest your first business, you probably practice. Your second business, you go for the best. So in your first one, what you should do is go through the full cycle of experience. So my advice is twofold. One is you should do a campaign to raise money. Do angel in parallel to a crowd activity. there are certain individuals that you should pitch. And by the way, if you don't have some other people when you go to the crowd, you probably won't succeed. So you need to have some friends, families, fools that are in first for the crowd to believe you. When you go online, the reason you do it is because you can't access them any other way. You don't know who they are. And what you're pitching is to a broader audience. And you're looking to try to, in this case, you guys came here and none of you knew me from Dubai. So if I couldn't see you today and I pitched online, that's what I'm trying to do. And therefore, it's the availability of pitch. But there's two secrets that I can give that might help on this one. Number one is the first 5 or 10 people that go on a campaign have to be people you know. And it's really, really, really important. You do not expect everybody to be somebody you don't know. So you get some people to go on there to show that there's traction. This is just like your eBay campaigns, right? If on eBay you don't have somebody bid that you know, your price isn't going to go up on the item you sell. So if you don't have some friends that are going in to buy your product or buy your shares, it's not going to happen.
Mm.
Number two, your story has to be really compelling online. And I can tell you a lot of the people that I've had pitch in the audience outside in the hallway aren't compelling. They're telling me everything else about their problems and their woes in their life. When you do your 1 minute or 2 minute video, it has to be punchy, engaging, and interesting. So I'll give you an example. One of the individuals was pitching some very cool technology to me in the audience, and I don't think they're here today. And it was on some synthetic bone growth, right? They can do automated 3D printing of a bone. And they said, isn't this really cool? I said, no. You have no story. He said, I can do it in every size, I can do it in every color, I can do it in every shape. I said, still not interesting. I said, but if you did it for somebody who was handicapped that had their arm blown off because of a mine or some IED, and you'd save that person in this situation, now I have a story. Or if you did it for an animal and you rescued some animal that had been caught in a trap, it becomes newsworthy. Now I'm interested.
Mm.
So it needs to have heart before head. Most of your pitches are head with no heart. And I'm sorry, I'm using this just as an example, not that the person didn't have a good idea. It was just find that heart attachment to do the presentation to connect what you're selling. So make it engaging for people, otherwise you're just an intellectual sale.
Very good advice, especially on the, it's very much about building relationships as well, right? People, it's about building trust.
Tough word. Trust marketing is a whole different thing. And it, you talked about transparency as a follow-on. In Malaysia, it's a different issue for lots of cultural reasons. Every society has challenges with how you communicate. In Japan, they have hone and tatamai, which is false face and real face. How are you today? Fine. We know better, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's true in a lot of Asian countries. We have the fake answer, right? So when you do your crowd campaign, we all know it's fine, the product works. Mm-hmm. We have no track record, we have nothing, right? So it's better that you're genuine. And here's three things you can do to be trustworthy. One is have a third party test your product. Don't have your brother, don't have your sister, don't have your co-founder test the product. Have a university, have a testing agency, validate that your product exists. Number two, have real sales.
Mm.
Don't have sales to one customer 20 times. Have it to multiple people and stand up and say that it exists. The third one is have KPIs that it performs. Whatever it does, it's performed for 5,000 hours, 20 hours, something. Make it so that it's real and legitimate in terms of that. And then you're showing that you're genuine. Don't sell a dream, sell something that performs.
Awesome. Sam?
Yeah, just back to your original question, Lies, about why would you rather go to the crowd than go to, say, to Kylie,
yeah.
Right? Now, I think both worlds are actually complementing.
Mm.
And if you look at sites like AngelList in the US, you see a lot of angel investors actually leading rounds of investments. Yeah, so I don't think it will be any different from here in Malaysia. I actually see people like Kylie actually leading rounds of investments on a particular company that will be listed on a crowdfunding platform. And I think for the crowd, it'll make sense because knowing that Kylie is actually leading that round and knowingly that Kylie will be mentoring this particular company would actually comfort me as a retail investor to trust that Kylie will do the right thing.
It's like one trust, one validation.
That's
somehow.
Right, yeah. Yeah. And I think
social proof.
And I think in a country where crowdfunding is still very not matured, no, that's not even the word because we haven't started yet equity crowdfunding, right? So I think we'll be relying more and more on lead investors, people who have cut their skin through investments to actually lead some of these particular crowdfunding initiatives. So if we were chosen tomorrow, I can share with you that'll be our strategy to actually get lead investors out there first. And then using them to then get the crowd excited to then also then pitch money to these particular companies. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When is the news coming up?
We believe the announcement will be for tomorrow morning.
Wow. Yeah. So we're all anxious about it. Big day tomorrow.
Hopefully everyone crosses their fingers that pitching will get it. Yeah. But yeah. I think it'll be a game changer in Malaysia. People always tell me, Sam, that you're probably smoking something if you think that this will be a game changer. It will be, but it will be challenging and difficult for both parties.
Yeah.
Yeah. We need two of them to tango to actually make it. Yeah.
Perfect. Let's talk about it. This is my last question because I don't know how are we doing on time. How much time do we have?
2 days.
We actually do have 15 more minutes.
Perfect. Last question, because I really am sure the crowd must have questions to you guys.
My apologies, Elias. We do have 25 more minutes.
Oh, okay. So let's talk about the story of our lives. No, I'm kidding. Still lots of things to talk about. Actually, that's super exciting. I believe a lot in like the meaning it could have for the tech community in Southeast Asia, actually more than Malaysia. Let's talk about funders. Maybe I cannot fund, I cannot represent a seed round here, but maybe I would love to support some startup I really like. What's the minimum startups should look at asking from people? Or what does it mean for a funder? How do I get into funding startups? And again, I think that all the things you were telling about what the startup needs to show, they'll tell a little bit about what why should be paying attention to. But from the perspective of someone who would fund, what's the profile of funders that are there currently in crowdfunding? Talking about crowdfunding again, right? Let's not talk about Pebble or about festivals. What's the profile of the current funders and what do I need to think when I want to become one? How do I identify if I am someone who could be a funder?
Good question, Lisa. And I think this is probably one of the reasons why a lot of projects fail on pitching. They fail to identify their early supporters even before they put their projects on pitching. I think Scott is on the spot when he mentions that the first few days is very crucial. Now imagine this: we all have this mentality, right? Say a company wants to raise. Okay, we're talking about reward crowdfunding. Eh? Reward crowdfunding. People want to raise say R$100,000 to do so and so. In the first week. Only two people actually put in money, which amounts to probably R$1,000. At week 4 and 5, again, the numbers are very small. I can bet you they will fail. Because I think people have this mentality that if the crowd is not there supporting it, then it's probably not a good project to support. Yeah? And that's why sometimes you need to strategize. Get your friends, your family members to actually support. Put some of them in the middle. When there is a lull, get people to support, and then strangers or the crowd see that and they will probably then just come in and start giving money, and before you know it, it becomes viral and the project just go beyond whatever they wanted to actually target. I've seen that a couple of times, not only on Just Pitch In, but also in other platforms like Kickstarter, Indiegogo. So that's why I stress the need for project owners to realize that it's actually work. Yeah, People think that after they do the video, come out with all the description, the rewards, my work is done. Now it's for people to just throw me money. It doesn't happen that way. It's work constantly, 30 days before, and if your project is for 60 days, the entire 60 days. So you're looking at a three-month project. Every week, every day, every week, putting in something new, reaching out to new people to actually get them to actually put in money. A good example is actually in Tapau Fest, the Indie Festival. Now, Faris wanted to raise 80,000 ringgit within 30 days. I told him in Malaysia that would probably be impossible, right? He did it by raising 90 days. But he actually spent every weekend driving to Ipoh, driving to Penang, driving to Kedah, going to cafes, putting out leaflets, meeting people. And that's what he needed to do to succeed. Yeah? And we don't see a lot of people who are willing to work that hard. But Faris did it. So if you're not willing to work hard, then the whole work that you've done in terms of crafting a video, putting in your description, would just come to a null. And again, it sounds cliche, but if you're not working hard to actually talk about your project, nobody would ever be bothered about it.
It's very much like building the relationship.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so about being a founder, Scott.
I can talk a little bit about the Middle East and some of the other countries, but I'll pick Eureka, which is an early stage, and it'll be similar in many ways to where Sam's going to take pitch in my expectation. Is they've done about 20 crowd fund deals. These are equity deals. What they ended up doing to get funders is they run two books, a book of funders and a book of candidate companies that want funding. So they're two side-by-side streams. In the investor group, what they do is they look for individuals who are higher net worth, who have some portion of discretionary income that they can invest in early stage ventures. They're normally already angels. Many of them are professionals, accountants, lawyers, practice people who have a high income that set aside in UAE, let's say 100,000 dirhams, which is only 30,000 US. They will put this aside and say, we would like to invest in early stage ventures. They'll even put it in an account with Eureka. So it's set aside, right? It's on tap. When one of the projects is of interest, they just say, tick, I'm interested in looking at this, learning more. They will probably even call the company before they just do something to invest. Because it's not just about looking at the website. You have to be ready, if you're raising money, to talk to people. And that's one of the differences is, as soon as you go open book, you have to be ready for questions, either email, phone, or otherwise, because you're going to have somebody who's on your equity records. They're going to be standing up with you. So most crowdfunding people are previous angels. And therefore, these are individuals who have either made money through real estate, through other investments, that they may have been a serial entrepreneur. We've got a couple in the room. There's an individual from Indonesia over there who's done a few hundred investments, so watch him. He's quiet. But he's a great person to learn from as to what he's looking for. He's an indication of the market. And that's why I like people like that, is they can tell you a lot about what's going on for why would they join a crowd or a platform in terms of this. The other thing about platforms is, if you were doing sports, you would practice. If you are serious about crowdfunding or crowd selling, go work with somebody else who's doing it to practice. Don't make yours the first. Go practice with somebody else. And I hope Startup Grind and other groups like that really match up people that are doing it with people that are willing to learn and help do it. Don't be the first time doing it, because you make lots of mistakes that you shouldn't do. So Sam talked to you about this curve of take up. What you want is a really good campaign. It may be 30 or 40 people that are putting in little bits of money along the way in the first 2 weeks. That creates the momentum. If you just expect them to do it because you talk to your brother or your dad, it doesn't happen.
Interesting. How different it is from now, asking from a very dummy founder perspective. That's myself. And how different is that from validation? Because imagine I'm still on my idea stage, and I'm actually developing now my MVP, my prototype, and I want to show it to the world to see if they are even going to sign up for that product. Imagine if they're going to put money for it. It's one step ahead. How ready do I need to have my product before going to crowdfunding? Or am I done if I'm really believing in my story? I have a vision, I have very good storytelling, and I have a cause. I start grouping people. How long can I keep them holding their breath? Okay, sounds like you got it.
Right, okay, that's actually an issue in Kickstarter once upon a time. When people actually, just based on ideas, they outsource the CAD drawings to a group of people who then draw this particular idea, and it looks fantastic online, and people just give money based on this particular vision which this project owner has for this particular project. But we've come across some of those projects which in the end the project owner just can't deliver what they promised. And this is just based on an idea. And I think Kickstarter then changed the rule that this allowed this kind of ideas to be put on the platform. So you need to have something tangible before you can actually then put on the platform. If I'm not mistaken, I think they changed some of the rules with that. But if someone were to approach pitching to do that, I would probably not allow them to put something which is just based on an idea. There needs to be more legs to the idea, because again, while every platform operators in the world would put a disclaimer that we're not responsible for undeliverable of project of the actual idea to the people who actually pledge money to it, it's something which we in pitching don't even want to risk it, right? And that's why I think if someone were to put in a project proposal to pitch in for the reward based crowdfunding, it has to be something tangible.
Mm.
Yeah.
I have an amusing response to your question.
I'm afraid of that.
CCA did a book a year and a half ago called Crowdfunding for
Dummies. I actually saw that in your website.
So there are some materials online, and one of the things, again, back to homework, is please go shop online. Please check out the different sites. There's probably 1,000 different sites around the world now, and there is a huge spectrum from those that are new to those that are mature. Read the blogs on them. Sam and the people in Malaysia are doing a good job at curating some insights about what those are. But there is material on campaigns, and campaigns are like SEO for social media. If you just say I have AdWords and you think you're a genius, you're probably not using the tools very well. The same with crowd, is please use the materials that are before you, or as they say, if you don't read history, you repeat it.
Mm-hmm.
Just to echo what Scott mentioned just now. Now, first of all, from the crowd, anyone that has not heard of Kickstarter before? Anyone? Well, you guys need to go to Kickstarter. They're a competitor to pitch in, but you know what? They're like a candy store. I go there every day. Scott too, I think, I suspect. So you go to Kickstarter, you'll see a lot of creative projects. Every day they get at least 500 proposals or projects that be sent to Kickstarter for them to be listed compared to pitch in. I can actually say that I sometimes beg project owners to put projects on pitching. So again, probably we don't have time to discuss this, but there's obviously this different mindset between creative people in this part of the world and also in other parts of the world. Here, platform operators, be in Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, struggle to get projects online. Various reasons. I'm afraid to fail in public, which I can't help you. I'm afraid that people will steal idea, which again is just a cop-out because you're not brave enough, I believe. Yeah. So people have all these excuses. Yeah. Whereas in the States or in Europe, a lot of people actually sharing ideas, because again, they need to know whether these ideas work. In Asia, there's always the thing about, I don't want to share my idea because I'm afraid that you will actually steal my idea. Mm-hmm. You should be sharing your idea because in the end, that person or group of people could actually tell you what works and what does not work with your idea. Yeah. So that's the number one challenge here in Malaysia for my SE. So, but I would actually stress what Scott mentioned. For you guys to even start something, you need to experience it. And that's why I would really, really urge you guys to look at Kickstarter, look at Indiegogo, spend $10, which is not a lot of money, yeah? Although the ringgit is dropping, yeah? But still, not a lot of money. You get used to it. I think I've done nearly 70, small investments in Kickstarter. And I'm sure Scott has done more than that. Have that, and once you do that, suddenly you have that fever of actually not only just wanting to start something, but also supporting other projects. If you have a good number of people here in Malaysia that believes in that, they'll see changed. Yeah? Mm. Right now, we don't really have a lot of people.
Okay. Yeah? I have one last question for both of you guys, because I really want to give back to the crowd, but it's from what you just said. I have a gut feeling that doesn't make sense to have a crowdfunding platform country-specific, especially if you are a small population. In the US, you have a kind of, it's no news, right? Even for a startup, any regular startup, starting from a global market or US market or markets like Indonesia, big country, or Brazil, you kind of have a critical mass of at least 1 million people who could share the same language and culture, and that's a critical mass. So how do you solve that in the case of Southeast Asia? We're so many small, and you can talk from your experience in the Middle East, but so many like small markets. And how do you break into that to build a critical mass?
You've got a great insight, but one flaw. Most people don't need much money. So okay. You don't need 1 million people to put in 100,000 each. Mm. In most markets, and if there's 18 million people in Malaysia, that's more than enough because you also have 1 million diaspora. And the diaspora is generally better off than the people that are in the country, because the people that are expats have money, so they speak the same language. The biggest issue about why it's regional or country specific has to do with only one issue, is where you're registered. Your legal equity base has to exist in one country. Until the UN says you're a UN company, you are either a US company, or you're an Indonesian company, or you're Singaporean, or you're a Malaysian company. That regulates your shares. That's the reason that you have to be specific to that. Now, can you be elsewhere? The answer is yes. You could set up another company, and it's common in the Middle East that they set up a BVI company, British Virgin Islands, and they run a branch in the UAE. You guys can do the same thing in some cases. You don't need to get that complicated though, because for the amount of money that you're trying to raise, it's probably in the market here. So several times in different sessions, I've seen the word storytelling. You need to become good storytellers to engage the market. You don't need a bigger market. You need a good story that's compelling as to why what you're offering people should invest in. And I think that there are different layers of crowd stuff as well. I'm going to add two other ones. You talked about prototype. There are markets that only deal with prototyping, that you can invest in a prototype. Companies do this all the time. GE invests in prototypes. That's all they do. They don't invest in the rest of the product. So you can pitch for funding for a prototype, and they will support it. And often all they want to do is see proof of concept, and what they would like is a right to be a reseller, which is quite neat in terms of that. The second for many of you is there is a site or several sites now that deal with finding co-founders. Now, as far as I'm concerned, that can be even more valuable than money for many of you, is that a co-founder can bring money, but they can also bring talent that you don't have to pay right away because they do it for equity. And if that's an outcome that you're looking for, salespeople and co-founders are expensive. So if you can get those for the right price, please, please, please pitch for those. And the last one is mentors. Good mentors are worth a bucket of money. And if you can do that in exchange for some shares or some future recognition, that's a wonderful thing. And that's where the crowd is valuable here. And I think a lot of you have been trying to tap into candidates for that. And that's part of what this networking discussion should be about. So I apologize for the stump speech.
No, that's great. I want to give feedback to the crowd, unless you guys want to add anything else.
Just one bit about equity crowdfunding, which will happen tomorrow. It will be legal in August, because I think the law needs to be gazetted. It's been passed already, so it needs to be gazetted. So by the time it's gazetted, it'll be in August. So my point is this: once it becomes legal in August, you guys can actually then fund companies and earn an equity or whole shares in some of these companies. Some of you guys will probably be retail investors. Your maximum will be 5,000 ringgit per company, capped to 50,000 ringgit per year. If you're an angel investor, meaning that you earn 15,000 ringgit per month, you can do up to 50,000 ringgit per month, 500,000 per year. If you're super rich, then you can actually fund whatever you want. Yeah. So the next question that I get, Elias, is from the crowd is this. So what does this mean? Can I actually fund a company tomorrow and later next week sell those shares, right? In equity crowdfunding platform, especially traditionally equity crowdfunding, you can't. Yeah, there is no mechanism where you can actually can liquidate those shares within a week or 2 or 3 weeks. Yeah? Sometimes the other way that you can actually exit is either through a trade sale, that company is actually sold off, or that company raised more money and the new guys that come in buy your shares. However, now this is where I think Malaysia is trying to differentiate itself from other territories or other countries in the world. I've checked in other jurisdictions, and maybe Scott can actually correct me if I'm wrong, but the SC is going to introduce a secondary market platform. Within the equity platform operators, they'll be given a license tomorrow, hopefully. So what will happen is this. 6 months after LICE, your company has raised money on Pitching, for example, the people who actually gave you money and now have shares in your company would be allowed to actually sell their shares in the open market in the platform itself. So that will allow Scott, the guy who actually put money into LICE, to now then liquidate, exit, and sell his shares and sell it to Nadira. If she, sorry, that's what I picked on you. So if she wanted to have to own ownership in your company. So that's exciting. Yeah, because that would put us, in terms of a country, different from other parts of the world. Yeah, so we're really, really stoked and excited to see that happening.
And one last question: foreign companies can apply there? Foreign companies?
You can, but then you have to be incorporated in Malaysia.
Of course.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I can invest through him.
Yeah.
But that's how I do
it. Yeah.
Oh, okay. You already found a way. Okay, guys, sorry. Questions from the crowd? Of course. Come over. Get a phone, because on the audio, you're going to kill me. The guys from the video. Get a mic.
Can you hear me?
Pass over.
Just a couple of things from my experience. So
first of all, you know, the question that you're asking, why will a founder go to a crowdfunding rather than VC. So one usual feedback that I get from founders, and these are founders who are mostly in Silicon Valley, is that you have VCs, but you have a huge power in crowd. So let's say if you're raising fund from 90 people, and 10 of them are CTOs of different companies, and if you're into enterprise software, so you can actually tap those CTOs to get your software out. A lot of the reasons, a lot of people reach out to me because most of these companies, Silicon Valley, wants to expand to Asia. And they like to have investors on the ground who can help them expand in Asia, right? So there's a huge power in crowd, not only the money. So that addresses to that point to some extent. In terms of people who are interested to be investor, I'm sure it's very, very risky. And I mean, you know it, right? Of the, you know, the startup life most of the time fails. VC life, and there's a lot of tweet storm going on now between us, Anderson Horowitz and Naveen from the AngelList and all these guys, Dave from 500. The VC life is pretty much same. So 50% of the VCs don't make money, though it looks like they make a lot of money. 50% don't make money. Of the rest, so 50, half of them actually make 1 to 2 times of the fund, which is lower than what you'd make if you invest into index firm in the market, which is much more liquid. Few make really big money. So if you're into crowdfunding, seriously thinking of taking investing in the next Grab taxi, you have to build a portfolio of 50 to 60 companies. Only then you'll be able to hit 1 or 2 Grab taxi. Okay, so that's very important to understand before you go into that.
So basically it's a traditional hunting unicorns kind of thing.
Yeah, you need to make a portfolio because most of it will fail.
And it's probably even hard, even if you invest, it's a numbers game, but not purely numbers. Sit down. Yes. Minimally, you need to have lots of eye as well, because if you invest in 50 companies, okay, I'm going to read top 50. One of them is going to be lucky. You still need to have lots of work per company, because this is generated. So that's actually, what's the... When I invest in a company, crowdfunding base, how much should I keep tracking them, paying attention to them?
So the way it works is, it depends how it works. So the whole idea of crowdfunding, I don't know how the secondary market works, because that's very interesting. Usually, so the big issue for startup is the cap table, right? You don't want to mess up your cap table. So you don't want 100 people on your cap table. And those of you who are recently setting up companies, use a company called eShares. It helps you to automate your cap table very well. Follow that. It's recommended by almost all the VCs. So you don't want 100 people on your cap table. So usually how the crowdfunding does is that they form a LLC, a separate company, and that goes into cap table, right? So one name under which there'll be 100 people. Now, who runs this LLC? So in case of AngelList, you'll have a syndicate lead. And when you're talking about syndicate lead, you're talking about very, very serious investors, right? I mean, investors who have invested in Uber, who have invested, I mean, all the billion-dollar companies that you can think of, right? These are the syndicate lead. So they will invest, their name will go in, and they will be basically the contact point for the founders to help. As investor, your involvement to the company is very little. If you want to invest, so if you want to create your network and want to invest, then you can. It's up to you. Then there's another model called Funders Club and WeFunder and others, where you don't have a syndicate lead, but you have people who actually, so they have an investment team in the part of their selection process, so they do all the work. So they do all the work in selecting the company and bring it to the platform, and then you can invest. Again, the expectation from the investors on a crowdfunding level is very little. So the founders don't expect that, but what I'm seeing nowadays is a lot of founders do actively seek out, because in AngelList you have a huge profile, right? You can go and exactly see who is investing where and what type of. So they actually go and specifically seek out specific investors who they want to be in their team.
You may also, as an investor, want a mentor or channel help. So there are some organizations that are here, like telcos or IT companies, that may be wanting to reach out into different areas. They may look for applications, and what they may be doing is hunting for potential future channel participants. So many times the crowd is more capable than money. So one thing you need to look at is when you put it out there, you may have people that are doing this to really watch what you're doing, including your competitors. One of the best things you can do is, as a crowd person, invest in your competitor, because you get all the information, you learn about it, and I do this as a genuine statement, not as a negative, it's a positive, is Uber has had Lyft trying to invest in them and vice versa, because that's what you do, is you try to find out what's going on in the other party. So on a personal level though, this comes down to two things. Please, please, please practice. Don't deal with this as theory. There are some people in the room that have had some practice. Borrow their ideas, but still go out and do your own practice. Like swimming, until you get in the pool, it doesn't count. Number two is, you have to do more than one. So your first one should really be small, and do it with somebody else, so you go through all of the steps. And you're going to make some mistakes, don't be worried about that. Do everything, so that you know it all. you may not be able to do 60 investments, you may only be able to do 10. That's fine, that may be great for your portfolio. You don't need to have 60. You need to do what's appropriate for you, but don't wait until it's safe. There was a movie called The Marathon Man that they just kept asking one question: is it safe yet? In many ways, that's Malaysia. If you keep saying that, you will be consumed.
Okay, questions?
You mentioned earlier about driving bus before launching your particular product or something on your platform. Can you give some examples of how they should drive bus?
Right, driving a bus.
Roadshow.
Roadshow. Well, again, a great example is actually Top Off Fest, this indie festival that was supposed to be held in Penang. And the guys who actually started this project and were successful started the buzz about it even a month before they went live on Pidgin. And you know what? It's really not rocket science. It's actually just going out there, doing your guerrilla marketing, even stopping people on the road just to say that, hey, I'm Faris, I'm doing this particular project. It's going to be live on Pidgin. This is the URL. When we go live, please visit. And this is what you'll get. So a lot of people don't do that. But you know what? That is what typically any reward crowdfunding project needs to do, to engage people, to communicate. And a lot of project owners in Pidgin fail to do that simple thing. Again, the belief that when I build it, people will just come. No, they won't. You got to sell it.
Yeah, if I may add to that, because I don't do crowdfunding at all, but what I do is mostly community building. And you need to minimally understand who is your crowd and know what attracts them. And it's all about the turkey in the Thanksgiving dinner. You put a turkey together for people to eat. What really matters for you are the people. But you gotta build hooks. In this case, maybe a road trip was a hook. But maybe your product isn't ready yet, but you can think of excuses, things you can do, can be an activity, can be an event, can be content online, can be a Facebook group that would attract the kind of crowd.
Yes, surveys, contests. But let me warn you of something, especially this room, because I've watched people using this device called a mobile phone. Mm. How many of you have Facebook in here? How many of you use your real name? If you were raising money and I looked at your Facebook, would I still raise money?
Yeah. Yeah.
Or would I know a lot about things you don't want me to know about? Remember, when you are transparent, they're going to look at lots of things. So please check your LinkedIn profile, your Facebook, and social media. I can tell you more crowdfunding and crowd campaigns have been killed because they have weekend photos of how they have had a very, very big party and done things that they shouldn't have had online, and it killed them raising money or selling product because they are not doing a good job on their website management.
Yeah.
So I'm talking about a turkey.
Turkey in the Thanksgiving dinner means just you put, you know, Americans should get the example better. It's more like you, just to clarify, you cook something, you do something for people to come. But that's just an excuse. The best example I have is just content. SEO is so important today because community building is all about to give before you take. So you give things that add value to them before you actually start asking for money. Yeah.
The other thing, Lex, is just to follow up what you mentioned about picking your community. Now, when Faris did his Top Off Fest event, he spent all his time talking to young folks below the age of 30. Yep. He did not bother to actually pitch this idea to folks my age. Scott's age, although I did support his project.
You feel excluded.
Because these are not his crowd, right? So first of all, if you're doing a book project, you probably don't want to list out party people who probably don't read books, right? So know your crowd even before you start reaching out to these people.
Yeah, and become your crowd. Like to hunt the fox, you gotta become the fox. That kind of thing. They didn't get it. Okay, guys, we got a cut. It was a very, very insightful conversation. I learned a lot. Thank you very much, Scott, Sam, Sajid, for joining us in the last minute. We should have had you earlier here. Thank you very much, everyone. Hope you had a good time.
Thank you very much for joining us. That was, of course, our final session for today. Funding Your Ideas, Crowdfunding and Crowdsourcing by Sam Shafi from Pitchin and Scott Gillespie from Jigsaw Group. After this, we're going to have a few minutes at the plenary, the ballroom over there on the right-hand side. It's going to be by our, of course, the people who threw this event for you, my IPO, Transforming the Traditional IP Marketplace. That's going to be happening in 10 minutes from now.